sense too. To go a little bit off the beaten path, because I've been thinking about this a little bit, just a little bit off, not a lot. We are experiencing all over the world today, people rising up in different countries. We have what we have in Egypt and Bahrain and Libya and Italy and all these people taking to the streets. Now, my thought is, collectively, at a quantum level, are we not all either A, participating in that or being affected by that to a degree as to perhaps either motivate or even change, cause us to, say, do the same thing?
Yeah, you talked about morphogenetic fields.
Okay, so is time travel possible? Well, it'd be a little bit like, is flight possible? Is it possible to build a vehicle where you can fly around in before there were any aeroplanes? Or when they were inventing the aeroplane? Well, okay, so you're inventing the aeroplane. You can see that it's possible. You can see that there are birds flying around, insects flying around. So you can say on the spot that flight is possible and you can build a machine to fly. So then you ask, is time travel possible? Evidence for time travel is with satellites orbiting at high speed away from the Earth, that the clocks on the satellites and the GPS have to be realigned with the time on Earth, because there are differences in time between the satellite and the clocks on Earth, caused by the speed of the travelling satellite. So there's evidence there. The other theory of sending a high-speed spaceship out to space, travelling faster than the speed of light and then coming back, and the Earth will have moved forward but not the the travelling craft, and so that when they come back everybody on Earth would be much older. Evidence for time travel can also be seen in quarks, travelling forward and back, or forward and back in time. So this is all fairly good evidence. Will we be able to travel in time? Well, I've said every now and then or off and on that we'll probably be able to view past and present events. But whether we'll actually be able to travel to those events, I don't know.
Black hole. So indeed, you actually don't see anything fall through. In case this concept sounds weird, that the passage of time depends on where you are in a gravitational field, there's actually a very nice terrestrial example. Your GPS system in your car works only because the physicists and engineers who designed and built GPS took this into account. The GPS satellites flying around up there are in a weaker gravitational field than we are down here on Earth's surface. And so, in fact, their clocks run a little tiny bit faster than our clocks do. And if this had not been taken into account, then your GPS would not work, in fact. It's the only, to my knowledge, current practical application in our everyday lives of the general theory of relativity.
So that was... let's see, Black Holes in Space, Hearts of Darkness, SETI Institute at 3105.
Well, actually, appears to be consistent with the laws of physics. We don't know if this is true or not, but Einstein's theory of general relativity allows the existence of closed time-like curves, and normally in physics there's a rule which is anything that is allowed is mandatory. No, it's true. So if it's not forbidden, then you can do it. And so, under that circumstance, it's important to actually try to figure out, from the laws of physics, how time travel might work. People have been doing this now for, since the 1940s, for more than half a century. So ever since Gödel figured out that Einstein's theory allowed time travel, and Wheeler and Feynman started talking about particles and electrons going backwards in time, there's been a lot of work on this done by people like Kip Thorne, who wrote some really great papers.
So that was, is time travel possible? Testing the grandfather paradox. Santa Fe Institute, 106 minutes and 25 seconds. And the next one is time travel possible, testing the grandfather paradox, Santa Fe Institute. It's the same lecture. And here he talks about the electron that turns into a positron as it travels back backward in time.
Oh, that's a good question. So the question is, if the electron turns into a positron as it goes backwards in time, does that mean the electron slows down before it does so? I guess so, because it's got to reverse. I don't know. Yeah. That's a good question. I don't know.
Yeah, so that was Seth Lloyd talking about the electron turning into a positron as it travels backward in time and then forward. It turns into an electron again.
Stories about time travel to the past. But normally, if we try to imagine something that we know is impossible, you can tell that you're trying to imagine something impossible. Like, here's a story. There was this guy, and then he had a circle, and it was square. And you're like, no, there wasn't. No, I can't do it. Or, there was this woman, and 2 + 2 were equal to 5. Like, you can say the words, but there's definitely a certain feeling that that goes with trying to imagine a story that's impossible. In the case of these time travel stories, I don't know about you, but I don't really get that feeling. I just feel like, oh yeah, and then they have a DeLorean, and then they go at the right speed, and okay, then they're back in the past. Like, okay, yeah, sure, I can imagine that. Doesn't seem likely or anything, but it feels like we can imagine it, and when we do it, doesn't have the normal feel of trying to imagine something impossible. So.
Okay, that's a good lecture, and I recommend that viewing that lecture. It's called Theories of Time. Is Time Travel Possible? And that's Dr. Ned Markosian. Ned, M-A-R-K-O-S-I-A-N. And Mr. Markosian is just talking about how likely does it seem that time travel is possible.
Einstein's general relativity laws reveal that time travel into the future is possible. They show that time is perceived differently depending on where one is in the universe and how one moves. Objects moving at close to the speed of light age slower than static objects. Objects near a gravitating body age more slowly than objects farther away.
Clocks run at different rates in different gravitational fields. The stronger the gravitational field, the more slowly time passes relative to someone out in space where there's no gravitational field.
Okay, so that was Mr. Alex Filipenko speaking on the documentary Wormholes and Superfast Space Transportation, just talking about the intricacies of time and speed affecting time and gravity as well affecting time. The channel is Science and Technology for You.
Set time and leap across the universe in moments. Here at the Multiverse Exhibition in Washington, D.C., this travelator helps us understand how warping space-time can get us across the universe without accelerating. The empty space behind your starship expands rapidly, pushing you in the forward direction. In the same way for this walkway, new space constantly emerges, which moves you along in that direction. At the other end of the travelator, we get a sense of what's happening in front of my starship. Space is compressed. In the same way in this walkway, space is being compressed, which moves you along. So you have the illusion that you're moving. Actually, it's space which is pushing and pulling you along.
So that was the documentary, How to Explore the Universe. Wonders of the Stars is the channel. And there they're discussing warp drive, which is the expansion of space behind the starship and the compressing of space in front of the starship.
Useful for my mission is that a combination of positive and negative energy pushes and pulls the starship forward. If I use positive and negative energy in the walls of my warp bubble, I could be in business.
This combination of positive and negative energy produces an expansion of space behind the bubble and a contraction in front. So in effect, you're creating space behind you, which pushes you along, and you're destroying space in front of you, which pulls you along.
So you can make a round trip to the stars and...
So there, they're just discussing, instead of actual propulsion, distorting the space-time in front and behind to actually propel the craft forward.
Inside a vacuum, particles smaller than an atom are continuously appearing from nowhere and then disappearing almost instantaneously. It seems strange, because it is.
Welcome to the weird world of quantum mechanics.
What's key is that these teeming microparticles create pressure. Imagine if you had two parallel plates very close together in a vacuum. There are fewer particles between the two plates than there are outside them. This creates a difference in pressure, and the two plates are pulled together.
That was again How to Explore the Universe. That was at 15 minutes and 37 seconds. That was Michael Kaku, and he's talking about subatomic particles that are everywhere, and how the attraction of two bodies come together because of the particles, less particles in between, more on the outside, and just in general, bodies are drawn together if close enough. This next clip I want to show is if you put in the search engine on YouTube, "The Universe is a Giant Brain," the channel is FMA264, and here's the picture here. So this is a brain cell inside of a brain, and the neurons are activated and forms memories. Apparently this is what thinking is, and memories are, is a line to like a pattern of lines to brain cells. This here on the right hand side is the universe, and it's made up of, you know, this is the very big picture, a similar type of look, the brain cell compared to the universe. Now I find science to be just incredibly interesting, just amazing things are found out. For instance, that picture of the brain cell as compared to the universe, it really does give fairly good proof that we live in more than just a thing full of particles and planets and solar systems and all the rest of it, that there is something definitely big that we don't understand about the place that we live, and science is just absolutely amazing, and it'll be very interesting what's found out in the future. Okay, so now we're up to the subject of the double slit experiment. This experiment was done a long time ago, I'm not sure, in the 20s or 30s, and it proved to be, to show some very unexpected results. It's just about firing a single electron through two holes, and what would you expect behind, on the board behind the two holes? You'd expect two lines, but what happened was they got a wave, or many lines, behind the two slits. I'll just explain that. Okay, so what they did is, I'll just see if this is all on camera, which it seems to be.
They got a machine that fired little pellets of light through a board like that with two slits in it, like that, with a big board behind. And they wanted to know what would happen when they fired them through the two slits. Of course, what you would expect is it would go through this slit and it would sort of land here. So, and the next one might go through this slit and it might land here. So what you would expect is two lines behind the two slits. But that's not what happened. When they fired through the two slits continuously, they got a wave. So a wave pattern. So if you imagine sort of wavy water going up against the wall, you get different waves. Now what they did is they then put a camera here to detect where the photons went through. And as soon as they put a camera on there, it only went through the two slits and formed only two lines, like that, as soon as they put the camera on. Then when they took the camera away, it turned into a wave. So that's sort of what's at the fundamental basis of science these days, and why science is pursuing all these different tests to try and work out the reality we live in. So there's a better picture of what I mean when they put a camera there and it observes these pellets of light. The light either goes through one or the other and forms just two lines on the blackboard. The scientists go on to say that when the data, like this data, is stored in a computer or whatever, and once that's destroyed, then it goes back to being a band pattern. Now, you know, I haven't seen any actual test, or they always talk about it, but they don't actually show the test being done. That's one thing I'd like to say.
Particles as probability distributions. It sees the fundamentals of our existence as a probability distribution. You've probably heard of the double slit experiment. It's kind of a famous thing in physics, but some of you probably not physicists.
An electron is a tiny, tiny bit of matter, like a tiny marble. Let's fire a stream through one slit. It behaves just like the marble, a single band. So, if we shoot these tiny bits through two slits, we should get, like the marbles, two bands. What? An interference pattern. We fired electrons, tiny bits of matter, through. And we get a pattern like waves, not like little marbles. How? How could pieces of matter create an interference pattern like a wave? It doesn't make sense. But physicists are clever. They thought, maybe those little balls are bouncing off each other and creating that pattern. So, they decide to shoot electrons through one at a time. There is no way they could interfere with each other. But after an hour of this, the same interference pattern is seen to emerge. The conclusion is inescapable. The single electron leaves as a particle, becomes a wave of potentials, goes through both slits, and interferes with itself to hit the wall like a particle. But mathematically, it's even stranger. It goes through both slits, and it goes through neither. And it goes through just one, and it goes through just the other. All of these possibilities are in superposition with each other. But physicists were completely baffled by this. So they decided to peek and see which slit it actually goes through. They put a measuring device by one slit to see which one it went through and let it fly. But the quantum world is far more mysterious than they could have imagined. When they observed, the electron went back to behaving like a little marble. It produced a pattern of two bands, not an interference pattern of many. The very act of measuring or observing which slit it went through meant it only went through one, not both. the electron decided to act differently, as though it was aware it was being watched. And it was here that physicists stepped forever into the strange.
So people have all sorts of different reactions to this. Three reactions. Number one, scared. They get scared and they think it's strange and they just block it out. Or you can just be interested and try and help work it out and just be interested. Some people discount it and just say it's you know, it's just rubbish. It's not real. My standpoint, my view is that it's just interesting, and there's definitely a lot we don't understand about the world, and interest in it, and you know, watch and try and educate myself. So that was The Matrix is Real, 2014. The channel is Christopher Copon. Okay, so moving on from the double slit experiment, we move on to a video, a lecture from SETI Institute. It's Inflationary Cosmology with BICEPS. The speaker is, I think, Chinese, Chao Lin Ku at SETI Talks. He's talking about anything you see out there is old. So it takes a certain amount of light from the sun to get here. You look at another solar system, and as you look back to very old solar systems in like the deep field, then you're actually looking at something that may not even be there or may look completely different if you are actually in that place, because of the amount of time that it takes for the light that you see to get to you from there. You know, that takes a very long time. And so if you were to view a planet that was in the deep field, if you had that technology, that planet may not even be there in real time, because of the light that you're seeing has taken so long to get to you.
The expansion makes it very big, basically. But just remember this. This thing in astrophysics, in astronomy, becomes time, or the age of the object. Okay, so the moon, as you see it tonight, is already 1.3 seconds old. The sun is already 8 minutes old. Polaris star is already 400 years old, as you see it. Andromeda galaxy is the farthest object you can see with naked eye. It's already 3 million years old when you see it. In fact, you can see it tonight if you know where to look. So the galaxies in the Hubble Deep Field, tiny little galaxies in Hubble Deep Field, each one is already billions of years old. Here's a picture of the Hubble Deep Field. So each one of these objects is a galaxy. But if you have a powerful telescope like the Hubble Space Telescope, picture here, and you look out, you see all the galaxies, not the stars. You zoom past all the stars, basically.
So I get a lot out of the videos on YouTube, the science videos. I'm watching them all the time, every day. I subscribe to channels that produce them. I comb through, all the videos I get, and I try and collect as many I can, and watch as many as I can. And this is my way of giving back to the science community, or to the science, to the scientists, educating. This is my sort of the small bit that I'm able to do, is collect and talk about the videos that I find. So here he's talking about gravitational instability, and it's the gravitational instability that brings events together and forms planets. And then he goes on to say, well, this gravitational instability, what is it that brought this gravitational instability into the world in a way that creates planets and galaxies? So why am I making these science documentaries? The main reason is that I see, out of all people, out of all groups, the scientists as being a group of people, probably the only group of people that can really move humanity forward. if there's any future for humanity, it's because of the scientists and, you know, what comes out of science and what theories come out of science and what's built from science and moving forward and giving people the view that we will eventually move forward, overcome our problems and maybe live on other planets and maybe even find other life out in the universe. How's it panning out for other life in the universe? Not too good. You know, yes, as they say, they've only viewed a very small area of the sky and only a few planets close to us. So there's plenty more to more areas to look for other intelligent life. Will we find intelligent life in the future? I've just got no idea. I suppose a lot of people expected us to find other life on other planets already. So we'll just have to wait and see. Okay, so the next video we get into Dr. Jill Tarter, searching for ET, an investment in our long future. This is from the this lecture's from NASA Ames Research Center. So the date here is January, the start of 2013. So, you know, it's about a year and a half old. So these are the statistics. Got 962 confirmed exoplanets, 3,845 candidate exoplanets, and 101 in the... I suppose you'd say in the zone for a habitable zone.
Habitable planets. You know, we really don't know. We know, perhaps, that the planet is Earth size. We know its distance from the star is potentially propitious. Sometimes we know its density, and we can say perhaps there's a rocky world there. But it's going to be quite a while. A disappointingly long time, I'm afraid, before we can say for certain what a habitable planet looks like and how many of them there are. All right, but recently at the SETI Institute, we were really pleased when Lisa Quintano and her colleagues announced the discovery of this particular planet, Kepler-186, the Kepler-186 system.
It's interesting to note the relationship or the distance from the Sun to the planet is very similar to Earth.
And the fifth planet, 186F, happens to lie in the habitable zone that surrounds the small star, Kepler-186A. And it's much closer to the Sun than the Earth is, because the star is much fainter. But this is looking like a very interesting target, and one that we should continue to study.
So here's a good picture of where we live in our Milky Way. We're just here, and when you look up to the Milky Way, you can see that it's sort of bright if you get a clear, lucky enough to live in an area with a clear sky and not too much light around you. You can see the middle is the brightest, and to either side is not so bright. That's because you're looking at your own solar system, and that's our galaxy there. Now, where the Big Bang, the origin of the Big Bang is, whether it's this way or where the actual Big Bang origin is in terms of direction there, I don't know. So I hope you have enjoyed this video. You know, I like to return the favour, if you like, from watching YouTube and educating myself, and I find this field of study to be very, very, you know, fulfilling indeed.